Good afternoon, everyone. I'm actually not Kosovians. My name is Anton Papanikolaou. I also work at Hypertech, and together with Kostas and Tasos, who are the lead authors of this paper, we are developing the technology that I'm going to explain in a few minutes. It's actually quite nice that the previous presenter gave a little bit of context about the relationship between future electricity grids and the buildings, because this will be very useful also for my presentation. So in the near future, there will be a strong need for the electricity grid and large loads, like buildings, to work together. And there are several reasons for that. So one is that we have a lot more renewable production, which is very unpredictable and very variable. And hence, the total load or total demand for electricity in the grid will somehow have to follow the actual production. And this is one of the reasons why demand response or demand side management or these kinds of techniques or buzzwords are coming up quite fast. So, what is demand response? It is a set of actions or mechanisms to reduce loads on the electricity grid when there is some contingency, like there's congestion in the network, or there is too low production of things, or the market conditions raise electricity costs, like the situation that the previous speaker just explained. So it might be that you want to follow the actual market price and consume electricity when the price is low. And the main goals are to improve the reliability of the grid and to lower also the energy costs at the level of the building. So just to give you in a schematic this context, let's see how this works. Yeah. Sorry for that, many buttons. Okay. So let's say this is the overall say grid, including the final consumers. This blue and this red boxes or contexts are actually the electricity grid itself. So you have here all the generation facilities. Here you have all distribution assets or tools or whatever. And this light blue box is actually the consumers. So what has to happen is that these loads, which can also include a lot of small generation like PVs on the roof or even small wind turbines here in the back, need to operate with the grid itself in order to find a good solution for both sides. So what are the current problems in demand side flexibility or demand response? Basically, the main challenge is to find demand or consumption flexibility within the building itself. Right, so if the building has to adapt its consumption profile, somehow it needs to be flexible in how it consumes electricity. And this needs to be somehow forecasted, or first it needs to be modeled. In the second step, it needs to be forecasted so that this collaboration between the grid and the building can actually happen in a coordinated manner. So today these models are completely stochastic, and they are typically unidimensional. So what this means is that the demand response today, how it works in the few countries where it actually works, like the US, is that they employ direct load control techniques, which actually means that the retailer or the grid operator will issue a signal directly to a load in the building saying that now you have to shut down, or now you have to curtail your consumption by so many kilowatts. And this, of course, implies consumer discomfort, right? So nobody wants actually the loads in the building to be directly controlled by another entity that doesn't know what the internal operations of the building are. The second main technique to encounter the problems of the first one is indirect control, which basically means that the grid operator will send a signal to the human living in the building or working in the building saying that I need now for you to change your consumption profile. But whether that happens or not is entirely up to the human, whether he actually takes a manual action to change the consumption profile. The experience up to now is that the first one works really well, but nobody wants to use it. I mean, really well in terms of performance and actual effectiveness for the grid. The second one does not work well, but of course everybody wants to have control. Now, what do we want to do, and what is the, let's say, the purpose of this presentation? We want to come into this equation and introduce intelligence. So find an automated solution where the grid operator can actually send a signal signifying whatever he needs. And then the building itself can actually respond to that signal, taking into account the needs of the people living or working inside this, this building. And for that, we need ambient intelligence, which basically means that we need to understand what's going on in the building, what people are doing, what they need, what they want. And on the other hand, to be able to understand what the grid actually is asking for. And a second, let's call it a side effect of our work, is that what we also try to do is we all try to optimize the buildings toward the, let's say, the needs or the wants of the dwellers or the occupants. So we want to turn passive houses into homes or offices into living workplaces, which actually means that the buildings can automatically adapt their, for example, indoor environment or other operations to what the people would like to have. So just, well, just to give you a bit of a technical aspect first. So what we do within buildings is we have a number of observable states. And for example, this can refer to the temperature in a building, the lighting conditions, the luminance levels, or the state of different appliances or loads. And then what we also have, also occupation profiles are important for us. And then what we actually want to extract is what is the preferred state of the building for the people themselves. Right? We cannot know that somehow a priori. So do the people within the building like the lighting conditions to be high or low? Do they want it to be much heat or very hot or not, and so on. So what we do, I'll go into more details in a few slides later about how we do that, but we have developed this Thor framework, which is an ICT solution that employs statistical techniques to take all these observable states into account and somehow try to understand what are these non-observable states, and based on this to control the assets of the building. Okay, so sort of interpretation and so on, that's very interesting. Our main objectives are human-centric demand-side management, which you can break down into, we want to have comfort for the occupant of the building, we want to have energy efficiency, so to remove any redundant consumption of the building, and we want to also want to facilitate demand response to the building. And at this moment, the main two comfort aspects or parameters that we address are the thermal and visual comfort. And this, of course, depends on several other parameters, which are what we call, well, not the black ones are observable states, like temperature, humidity, luminance, and so on. Metabolic rate and airflow and stuff like that are a bit more different to measure, but I will go into a bit more detail. So how do we do this? This diagram shows the luminance level in the building, which is this blue line, and then this green line is actually the power consumption of the lighting system. And this is a baseline situation where, for example, when the natural lighting becomes too low, a user would go to the switch on the wall and turn up the lights. And then in the second, perhaps in the second room, after a while, another person would go up and switch on and out of the lights, and so on. Now, what we do, why I show you this? This is important because these are all observable states. We treat these as observable states. So we can measure the luminance in the building, in the different rooms, and we can also measure what are the actual actions of the building occupants. So this action that a person actually goes to the wall and turns a switch signifies that he's not comfortable at the current settings. And if these lights give him several options, if for example, dimming levels, it can also signify what his comfort level is. Right? So by gathering all these different signals, plus a few more, we can make what we call a discomfort profile. So this is a curve, well, the horizontal axis is the luminance level. This is in lux, but it can be in anything else. And this blue curve is actually a weighted indicator that signifies the discomfort of individuals, actually the visual discomfort, right? So what conditions they're happy with. And we take here, for example, an arbitrary threshold and say that this 0.11 means that the comfort level at this 120 lux is 0.89, or at 89%, and anything below that is, for example, unacceptable, and so on. This is an arbitrary threshold. Again, for the equivalent in for thermal comfort would be something like a bathtub where for very cold temperatures you start the high discomfort, then you have a range where comfort is high, and then of course when temperature goes too high, discomfort raises again. So we have a few different models and profiles to model comfort and discomfort. Why have we started with those two explicit aspects of comfort? Well, this is an aggregate consumption of buildings. It's just a representative curve coming from the States. But it breaks down energy consumption into the different building loads that actually consume the energy. So we see that air conditioning, lighting, ventilation, exterior lighting, and so on, if we add these up, these are quite important in the overall energy consumption of buildings. So by treating these two aspects, thermal and visual, you can already start influencing a significant percentage of the total consumption of a building. Plus another good side effect is that typically you can change the set points of these things from a distance, right, which is always good in an ICT framework. So these are on the bottom are just typical devices today, smart thermostats or heat pumps or these kinds of things where you can actually modulate their set points of operation from a distance using an IT framework. So how does this actually work? This is the blue line is the lighting profile of a single day measured somewhere in an office. This orange part is actually the state of the lights or the set point of the lights as it would be controlled by individuals. So these are actually at measurement, they're not extrapolations. We have measured individuals to control the lights this way in a typical working day. And then the green curve or the green area signifies the potential energy consumption, so the area of the energy consumption, or represents rather the energy consumption, is the energy consumption that would actually be consumed if an automatic system would take charge of the lighting system. So we can observe several different things here. So first of all, users, actual humans, would take very large actions, so just turn everything on or everything off, or if you have dim, maybe put it 50% or so. And they do it not very frequently, right? You would not very frequently go up the wall and start playing with light switches. Now, on the other hand, an automated system can respond in much faster steps to changes in the actual luminance of the room. And this means that automating this step, assuming that you already understand what the occupants want, you can already reduce the energy consumption of the light itself for the same let's say level of activity in the room or the same comfort, and that directly translates into efficiency. While on the other hand, having this automated system also gives you the opportunity to respond to stimuli from the grid to do something, to change somehow your consumption of your building. There's a similar situation for the heating control, basically, where here it's a little bit more complex to explain because things overlap a lot, and because typically the level of this power consumption is basically up to the HVAC device. So this is a heat pump, and what we do actually here is we manage to turn it on a bit earlier than it actually wood, and by doing that, basically we leverage the dynamics of the temperature within the building, so how the thermal mass of the building can be used in order to preheat in a smart way, in order to keep the overall consumption to a bit lower level. So it's obvious here that you don't gain a lot, so the differences between this light blue, or I'll call it, and this orange part, but still can see that in this case, without any loss of comfort, we can gain some energy consumption. Do I still have time? Okay. So we have demonstrated these technologies in a few different places. I should mention that these have been developed in the context of European funded projects, so FP7 Horizon projects. And we have several developments active now in the past in several different European countries. And we have also built a user interface or a tool for the facility manager, for the person who monitors the operation of the building and tries to fine-tune them. So this is just a typical interface where you have the layout of the building. This is obviously an office building. And you can monitor different zones and how each zone actually behaves in terms of energy consumption and comfort on the individuals there. Of course, this comfort corresponds to the profile, the model that we created as I showed in advance. And then depending on the actual conditions, either enforced by the facility manager or by the system itself, we can monitor how the people feel within the building. In terms of thermal comfort and visual comfort. We can see here, for example, that we can keep comfort quite high with some not negligible savings in energy consumption in the HVAC system of the building. And for visual comfort, the gains are actually much higher, even though the aggregated consumption of lights is lower, of course, than HVAC. We still quite high comfort, mainly because of this inertia of people who don't actually tune the lights at the fine grain level as they would like. Not everybody likes to go to the wall very often and tune the lights. So this, in a nutshell, was the technology we are developing. Excuse me for that. So of course now we have a lot of work still ahead of us. The first bullet regards flexibility, which I've not gone into much detail yet, well, in this presentation. But now that we have several pilot operations ongoing, we also want to evaluate what is the amount of demand flexibility we can extract from the building using such tools. And of course, what is the impact of using this flexibility on the comfort of the occupants of the building. Then we can design all kinds of integrated strategies with different optimization objectives, which can include, for example, cost reduction, energy cost reduction at the building level, also take into account the market price signals like the previous presenter mentioned, or go for demand response or comfort and so on. Of course, we need to add more loads to this equation. So now we have only the lighting system and the HVAC system. There are more things consuming energy in buildings. And we also, to be honest, up to now, most of the evaluations were done in commercial buildings, tertiary offices, stuff like that. We want to have more detailed results in residential premises to see how this technology responds there. So thank you very much for your attention.